Good morning, students. In the previous video, we studied about the structure of courts in India. We studied that there are three different levels of courts in our country: Supreme Court, High Court, and the subordinate or the lower courts. There are several courts at the lower level, while there is only one at the apex level. At the top is the Supreme Court. That is located in New Delhi and is presided over by the Chief Justice of India. The decisions made by the Supreme Court are binding on all other courts in India. Each state has a High Court, which is the highest court in that state. And then we have at the tehsil or district level, the subordinate courts. So the courts that most people interact with and what are called the subordinate or the district courts. Then you must be wondering as to, are these different levels of courts connected to each other? And so the answer is yes. They are all connected to each other. In India, we have an integrated judicial system, meaning that the decisions made by higher courts are binding on the lower courts. Another way to understand this integration is through the appellate system that exists in India. This means that a person can appeal to a higher court if they believe that the judgment passed by the lower court is not just. Another point to show that these courts are connected to each other is through the point we studied in the previous video, that these courts, the Supreme Court or the High Courts, they act as a court of record. So they maintain all the previous records of the cases, and all the judgments of the Supreme Court or the High Courts are duly recorded and printed. The lower courts treat these judgments as laws. Thus, in India, there is one uniform judicial system. So now we can say that all these courts at different levels are connected to each other. Now, in this video, we will study about the role of the judiciary and the need of having an independent judiciary. So the courts can take decisions on a very large number of issues. They can decide that no teacher can beat a student, or about the sharing of river waters between states, or they can punish people for particular crimes. And so, broadly speaking, the work that the judiciary does can be divided into the following three broad categories. First one is the dispute resolution. Second is judicial review, and the third is upholding the law and enforcing fundamental rights. So the first one is dispute resolution. It resolves disputes between citizens and the government, between two or more state governments, and between the center and the state government. So if there is a dispute between two people, or between the citizen and the government, or between the two states, or between the center and state, then again the judiciary comes into action to settle the dispute. Like when we have a dispute between two states regarding the water of a river, like the Kaveri River dispute between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. There also, it was the court's decision which was to be followed by both these states. And the second one is judicial review. The judiciary is the final interpreter of the constitution. It has the power to reject particular laws by the parliament if it believes that these laws are a violation of the basic structure of the constitution. This is known as judicial review. And the third one is upholding the law and enforcing fundamental rights. The judiciary upholds the law and enforces fundamental rights. Any citizen of the country can approach the Supreme Court or the High Court if he or she believes that his or her fundamental rights have been violated. And like we studied in class 7 book about Hakim Sheikh, an agricultural laborer who fell from a running train and injured himself and whose condition got worse because several hospitals refused to admit him. On hearing this case, the Supreme Court ruled that Article 21, which provides every citizen the fundamental right to life, also includes the right to health. It therefore directed the West Bengal government to pay him compensation for the loss suffered, as well as to come up with a blueprint for primary health care with particular reference to treatment of patients during an emergency. And now, the need of an independent judiciary. So, what is meant by an independent judiciary? Independence of judiciary means that the other organs of the government, like the executive and the legislature, must not restrain the functioning of the judiciary in such a way that it is unable to do justice. That is the separation of powers. So it means that the other branches of the state, like the legislature and the executive, cannot interfere in the work of the judiciary. The other organs of the government should not interfere with the decisions of the judiciary, and so that the judges must be able to perform their functions without any fear or favor. The courts are not under the government and do not act on their behalf. The judiciary of India is an independent body. It is separate from legislative and executive bodies of the Indian government. The legislative and executive, that is the central and the state governments, cannot interfere in the work of judiciary. The courts are not under the government and don't act on their behalf. The judges in the High Court as well as Supreme Court are appointed with very little interference from the branches of the government. It is also very difficult to remove a judge from his or her post. Once appointed to his office, it's very difficult to remove a judge. He can only be impeached. And it is this independence of judiciary that allows the courts to play a central role in ensuring that there is no misuse of power by the legislature and the executive. It also plays a crucial role in protecting the fundamental rights of citizens, because anyone can approach the courts if they believe that their rights have been violated. So for the protection of the fundamental rights, it's really, really important for the judiciary to be very fair and independent. So why does the judiciary need to be independent? To provide a check on the government and have no political bias, meaning the politicians or the ruling party cannot influence the decision of the judiciary. And then judges cannot collude with the government if they are independent. So it is vital that judges are free from any kind of pressure or influence from outside sources, such as politicians or pressure groups. They have to act according to the law and not according to the wishes of groups outside the judiciary. This ensures that we receive a free trial. And like we saw in the previous slide, an independent judiciary is needed for the protection of fundamental rights, provide remedy for their violation, and also for judicial review. And as we studied in the previous slide, what is judicial review. As the final interpreter of the constitution, the judiciary also has the power to remove particular laws passed by the parliament if it believes that these are a violation of the basic structure of the constitution. So these two topics we have completed today. Please answer the following questions. Define judicial review. Which key feature of the constitution ensures independence of the judiciary? When can a person approach the courts? What do you understand by independent judiciary? If you read the chapter carefully, you'll find all the answers in the book. So when can a person approach the courts? When the citizen feels that his fundamental rights are being violated, he can approach the courts. Which key feature of the constitution ensures independence of judiciary? And the key feature is the separation of power. So please read the chapter and answer the following question. Thank you, children.